is time for a Q&A. You asked, I shall try to answer. First question is from Russell F64, who asks, I am buying my first loop pedal. Awesome. Do you have any recommendations? Well, yeah, I'm a big fan of the TC Electronic Ditto. This is the Ditto Mini. This is the X2. There's a bigger version, about twice the size of that. It's the X4. These buttons on the front of it, before you all ask, are by Barefoot Buttons. You'll find them linked below. Not a paid commercial, just a big fan of their buttons, and it's a bigger target area, especially when it comes to looping, to hit and be a little more accurate. There are, of course, pedals like the Boss RC3 and many other pedals by Boss, very well known for their looping pedals. There's stuff like the Akai Head Rush if you want to get really old school, or Boomerang. There's a looper in the HX Stomp by Line 6 if you have that. If you have the old DL4 by Line 6, which was my very first looper, there's 14 seconds of looping in that. 28 seconds if you start recording at half speed. But for the price and for the punch and the compactness, I do highly recommend the Ditto Mini. Next question is from Love Liege. Okay. If you could only use one fretting hand warm-up, which one would it be? Oh, if I could only use one. I'd hate to be restricted to one thing. It would probably... Hang on a second. It would more than likely be something out of my book, The Bass Player's Warm-Up. There are 10 of my favorite exercises in here, warm-up exercises. That's why I wrote this little book. That is linked below if you want to check it out. Nothing crazy, just something simple, something to get the blood flowing, something I don't really have to think about too much. Maybe I'm a little groggy first thing in the morning getting into my routine. Something that's gonna warm up my fingers and not put any strain on anything and just get me ready for the practice session. Bass Daddy 5 asks, what is your broad philosophy slash approach to improvisation, i.e. your number one guide slash rule? That would have to be very broad if I was gonna sum it up in one thing. If I can be cheeky and maybe have two or three broad things to explain my philosophy and my approach to improvisation, those would probably include the ability to tell a story, the ability to bring the audience along on the journey, the ability to do that honestly, and to do that with great time and sound. I talk a lot about time and sound. There's a huge focus of my playing, of my everyday musical experience. That's a massive part of it. So the overall picture is more about being in control of time and sound, no matter where it sits on the spectrum. Suma underscore can asks, how do you avoid falling into the I already know all this laziness? Well, first of all, none of us know all of anything, as far as I know. And I know for myself, when it comes for music, the amount of stuff I don't know far outweighs the stuff I do. So that is never an option for me. I can never fall into that that area of laziness. Can I be less motivated at times than others? Well, absolutely, for sure. And I think if I'm not motivated to do something, then it's probably best to take a break from it and come back when I am really truly motivated to spend the time and do the work. Lee Braverman Bass asks, how does your approach differ when improving a bass line or groove compared to a solo? I'm not sure whether you meant improving or improvising. Let's see. Let's take both of those words. I'm always trying to improve everything. That's why I practice. That's why I listen to music. That's why I do what I do. That's why I get out of bed every day. Let's maybe say that you meant improvising. So I can answer that one as well. It's, again, like I said before, all about time and sound. When the time and the sound is good, the message is normally being conveyed in a way that it's there's a high chance of it being understood. So I'm always trying not to overcomplicate things. If I can take something out rather than put more stuff in and have it be as effective, if not more, that is quite often a common goal of mine, whether that's in my practice routine or whether that's in the moment on stage as the music is unfolding in real time. The Great Elmer asks, is pancetta or prosciutto? Okay, I know I said ask me anything. I don't know why you think I'm any kind of authority on this question, but okay. Is pancetta or prosciutto better in a traditional red sauce? Okay, I'm not First of all, red sauce. What is red sauce? Are we talking about a ragu? Are we talking about what that becomes after it's a ragu, or the base for that, a basic tomato sauce that goes on a pizza or something a little thicker? Personally, and this is just my personal opinion, and from what I've experienced being in Italy so much, for instance, prosciutto di Parma, if you're going to cook prosciutto di Parma, I think you kind of have to be a little bit out of your mind. Yeah, I don't know. Pancetta for me is so much taste. You don't have to use too much of it. There's nice salt in there. And yes, I do use pancetta in a bunch of different things as a little base, maybe frying that with some onions or frying that with some garlic in the beginning of the story when that comes along. I'm sure there are plenty of Italians right now going, no, or yes, or swearing profusely, or
che cazzo è sto piatto qua, non lo so, boh.
Throwing the tomato paste at the screen. I don't know. It's just my personal opinion and my experience. Probably best not to cook prosciutto di Parma. It tastes unbelievably good on its own. Like, there's no need to do that. And pancetta, guanciale, those, oh, yeah, don't get me started. This could be a whole thing on that. Next question. Spence or Plata asks, do you still play the Music Master? Side question, can I buy it? Spence, sorry, you can't buy it. That is staying with me for a long time. And right now, I don't play the Music Master because the pickup, the electronics are not great. That really needs an overhaul. And since we've all been in lockdown and everything's been closed, I haven't been able to do any maintenance on all this stuff back here at all. I'm not qualified to do it. I really want to take it to someone who's good. Maybe even have a custom pickup wound for it. Put something new in there. And yeah, but I love the instrument. I'm not selling it. And as soon as I can, I will be playing it again. The next question is from Samed Merrill or Same D Merrill. However, either way, they ask, the high C string, how did it become part of your playing? What made you first try it? I think I was first aware of the high C string from six string bass players, from listening to people like John Patitucci play in the Chick Corea Electric Band. And then I think I'd heard maybe someone like Dominic de Piazza maybe play with a high C. Not sure about that. That could have been a low B, but getting towards that vibe, that kind of solo bass and playing melodically and chordally. It was definitely Patitucci and Dominic de Piazza in the beginning. And then it was a range thing. I know the first person I saw live do that was Matthew Garrison in about 1998 or 99, somewhere around there in Boston while I was going to school. He was playing with John Scofield. I went to check out John Scofield. That was the first time I heard it live. And then I think I did it for the first time somewhere around 2003. So it took a while to make the switch. I had a long time low B player as my main instrument. And then, made the switch in about 2003 and haven't looked back. Aiden Berg asks, your loops always groove so hard. Well, thank you very much. What would you suggest to enhance groove in looping? Well, I would say, okay, hang on. Instead of walking back and forth, because I know the answers to a lot of these questions are going to be in some of these books. This is why I wrote Bass Player's Guide to Looping, specifically for that, specifically for working on, I mean, it sounds kind of silly, right? But I get, read a book about groove and about how to do it with looping. But there are a few key technical things that I talk about in the book, which really do help with the way you input that information into the pedal and how to create kind of groovy loops and use percussive elements. That doesn't, however, make you a good groove player. The groove, I think, has to come regardless of whether you're looping or not. And I think the more you work on jamming along to records and really checking out the great groove players of the history of the music we play, I think the more you do that, the better you're gonna be when it comes to grooving with the looper. And then it's just a couple of little technical things, some stuff I put in the book about how to really execute that. You know, a few things I've learned from trial and error over the years, and they could well be some of what you hear when you listen to my loops. And apparently, thank you very much for that, dig the groove that's happening there. Joe Gwynn asks, do you try and limit the effects in a sound to only what's necessary for the song / sound? Joe, I'm going to guess you're asking about my signal chain, and do I limit that for the music I'm playing? I am as much of a crazy pedal fan as you can see. I'm like surrounded by pedals here. They're all over the place, all over the desks, the shelves. I am a crazy pedal fan. The irony being that when I have the chance, I'll use no pedals in the signal chain if I can really get away with it, if that is what, as you say, is right for the song and right for the sound. So yeah, I'm a big fan of stripping it down, even though you probably, if you see me live or you see the pedal studio or any of these videos, you probably see a lot of pedals in action. I do like to keep it fairly simple. And my signal chain, regardless of what kind of colors I'm adding to it, will normally include very slight bit of compression just for some warmth up front, and a couple of different preamp options with the exotic EP booster, the Aguilar DB925. And then who knows after that? Yeah, maybe a volume pedal. I use the HX Stomp by Line 6 a lot, of course, but that's not always the right thing for the song or for the sound. So yeah, I'm a big fan of stripping it down wherever I can. Aperio 2000 asks, did you ever make vlog number 365? I can't find it on YouTube. Thanks. I did not. It is still pending. I still haven't found something worthy of the end of the vlog, or at least that the end of that first year of the vlog. And it might actually be that I've found probably way too many things that are worthy for it, and I'm trying to, you know, it's just a tough choice to decide which one's going to be 365. I should just throw a dart in a board, make the video, and move on. Hark Ali Bass asks, hi Janek, what helped you most to find your voice? I think the thing that comes to mind the most was not wanting to sound like other people. That was that may sound kind of simple and obvious, but that was a real motivating factor when it came to that. I just really didn't want to sound like another bass player or another person, even someone that I admired and loved and still listen to today. For instance, like I love John Patitucci, for instance, but I don't want to sound like him. I would like there to be some differentiation between me and John, or me and just anyone. Just always looking to find that uniqueness, that individuality. So that was always a motivating factor. And it was also something I realized quite early on that was going to be my ticket out of the circuit of being a sideman, and the circuit of relying on other people's schedules for my income, for my musical output, for my ability to play live. So it was about control of my career as much as it was about the uniqueness of sound and the individuality that I was looking for. Marshall Grego asks, did you write your solo on Light Years or just go for it? Love where that solo goes, sounds so natural. Thank you very much for checking out the music, Marshall. And he is referring to Light Years, which is a song from my latest album, The Union. One of the few bass solos on the record, actually. And no, I didn't write the solo at all. That was one take in the studio, no editing. It was, you know, live with the band, and I just went for it. That's always the goal. It's really always to be in the moment, be in that flow state, and for it to be totally natural, for it to lead from one place to the next and have a beginning, a middle, and an end, and have shape and phrasing and articulation, and for it to say something. So I hope I achieved that in that solo. That's definitely what I was going for when I was in the studio, and what I'm going for every time I go to take a solo or just go to play music in general. Andrew Rurda asks, you've probably answered this somewhere already, but what's your lighting and filming rig? Good that you ask about the lighting, because I think that is almost more important than the camera setup. It changes, I'll say that, and it morphs, and I use different things for different situations. What I'm using right now is a Sony camera with a Sony lens, and then, but the lighting, I have a light over, oh, you see it a little better there. You might even see it right in the corner of this video because I didn't frame it very well. Look at that. Look at me showing my production incompetence. Here we are live on the show. There's a little, I have just a desk lamp here. I'll show you here. See if I can. It's just, you know, little desk lamp. A little dusty. Needs a tone brush treatment with an Edison bulb in it. And it's just a nice little kind of warm light. I also have there off camera a quite large window, but it's 11:30 at night here, so there's no light coming in it. But during the day, I get some nice natural light from the canyon coming in there. In the back, I have these two, where are they? There they are, two Edison bulbs in the back. And up here, I have an Aperture light dome. It's huge. It's, in fact, you can probably see it in the reflection of the book. Look at that. You can get an idea. It's pretty big. So you see my camera over there with the monitor in between my two computer screens. So yeah, that's the basic setup. It is quite basic. It's a camera. It's some lights. Good quality, of course. That helps, you know, producing sort of 4K stuff like this. I did not go to film school, never had a lesson or anything like that in my life, but YouTube is a wonderful place with a lot of great people like Peter McKinnon, for instance, who can teach you lighting, and Casey Neistat, who, if you just watch one video, can basically give you a clinic on editing. That's where my vlog style was stolen from, and where most of my editing skills come from. And then there are all kinds of things about coloring and post-production, and I edit in Final Cut. I really wish I didn't, but I learned that, and I'm not prepared to learn anything else right now. So that's the basic setup, kind of the long version of that, but that's what it is. The Keith Bianchi Biacchini. Wow, I'm sorry, you got a really long handle, and when it's all strung together like that without any space. Keith asks, what is your favorite instrument that you don't play? Great question, and I'm gonna say cello right away. I know it's kind of in the range of an instrument I do play, but I think about this one album by Yo-Yo Ma and Ennio Morricone, where Yo-Yo Ma is playing all Morricone's melodies, that I gravitate towards that kind of stuff. And Dvorak, like cello concerto and Wagner, all this stuff is there's crazy great music written for cello in all worlds that I'm a huge fan of, and I guess that might be something high on a list. If I were to say, oh, I would like to learn a new instrument, it would be that. Love to do something expressive with the bow that wasn't the double bass, that wasn't quite as low down there. I think that cello range is pretty beautiful to my ear. CJ underscore arc asks, who do you suggest to transcribe for any genre? Interesting. Well, it really depends what you want out of it, doesn't it? There's no like one person. I can't say, oh yeah, transcribe, you know, Miles Davis and you're going to be a great prog metal player. You know, that, you know, it might help somewhere along the line. It'll definitely teach you some harmony and some melody, but I think it really comes down to what inspires you, and get in the genre that you want to play in and go after the masters of that. Go after the people that really like give you those like bug eyes, like, whoa, what is that? I must learn this. When you're that inspired to learn something, that's the moment. That's the most valuable moment, I think. If you can have that experience where you're like, I don't understand this, but it's having an effect on me and I want to be able to play this on my instrument, that is the connection to the music that I think you need, that makes transcription just 50 times more valuable than just transcribing for the sake of it. Gavin Forbes Music asks, have you considered Gig Rig Wetterbox 4 Autobit, parallel issue? Love your current setup, Gavin. Thank you. Yeah, I've looked at, so there are a lot of other solutions out there, right? I've seen the Wetterbox. There are a few others that I've been looking at. It's all a question of, I have the Stereo X Blender from Exotic, so I'm using that because I don't really want to sink a bunch of money into something that I'm going to use, you know, maybe 5% of the time, and who knows if that is the final solution. You know, I've heard that Fractal actually doesn't have any phase issues in effects loops in parallel like that. You know, Line 6 might even be working on trying to rectify that in the Stomp, for instance. So right now it's not an emergency. It's not like I have to go out on the road next week and use it and be like, you know, have something that's totally rock solid. The Wetterbox looks great. I'd love to talk to those guys. I talked to Dan, right? For that pedal show, Dan, that's Mr. Gig Rig and Wetterbox designer builder, as far as I know. Yeah, I'd love to talk to him about that and just about that kind of stuff in general, and also Josh from JHS Pedals. I really want to talk to him about stuff like that and routing and signal path and parallel stuff. So I have a lot to learn on that. I'm probably not going to buy anything else, as I already have a solution that works great for recording and for being at home, and we'll see how it evolves. Wasimoto underscore asks, workout in the morning versus in the evening, music practice before or after workout? Well, okay, so there are so many schools of thought with working out. Is it better to work out in the morning? Is it better to work out in the evening? What are the benefits of both? The sleep, recovery, like all of these things that go into that equation. Listen, at the end of the day, whether you work out in the evening or work out in the morning, the workout you do is better than the one you don't. As long as you're not straining something and doing something that's so extreme or kind of just stupid, as long as it's in the realms of, you know, something sensible, I think it's kind of valuable either way. So it's up to the individual. I know that, for instance, if it's a specific training mode that I'm in, I'll work much better and much harder, and I feel better working out in the morning, and that works better with my day. But sometimes, you know, I was at one point doing two a days in the gym, plus once a day on the tennis court, so three times a day. So what is that? That's morning, noon, and evening. Not night, but evening. Right now, I've just built a gym at home, and I'm working out, you know, probably 6 days a week again now. So that's once a day. I'm normally doing it sometime between breakfast and lunch. Not that I eat lunch that much. I generally tend to skip lunch, but some, you know, I'm trying not to do it late. If I am doing it late, I have a stationary bike, so it's more like a stationary bike ride. It's not like lifting weights or doing a whole bunch of, you know, body weight exercise stuff. I don't try and smash it so hard right before I go to bed. And then with the practicing, it's a little easier for me to schedule. I like to do at least two sessions a day. I like to do one in the morning and one in the evening. And if I can, I'll sneak one in the middle of the day as well. So three a days are ideal for me. If I can do 3 2-hour sessions a day for practicing, that's ideal. Sometimes it's only 20 minutes. That's when I go to like this book and just, or any book actually, any of these, and just grab an exercise and rock it for 20 minutes just to do a little bit of maintenance and keep loose. Jay Mantis asks, what are your positives / negatives of the Boss Switcher? I imagine you are referring to this ES5. This needs some major tone brush treatment. It's filthy. It's been sitting on the floor too long. What are my positives and negatives of it? Very few negatives, actually. The one big negative that I found out recently was that I'm in the same boat as the Line 6 HX Stomp when it comes to the parallel loop setting. And when I wanted to put the Meris Otto Bit Jr. in a parallel loop and be able to switch that on and off, when I had the Meris off and the loop was still open, there's a huge phase issue, digital analog kind of thing, and that massively alters the sound of my instrument. So that was kind of a drag. Other than that, it's great. It's like highly programmable. For the price point, I've got to be very transparent here. Boss sent me this for free. I did not pay for it, but they're not also paying me to hype up their product. I just do dig it. But yes, had I had to pay for it, the price point would have been a massive factor. And I think that's a good factor as well. The ES8 was a little big for my liking. So this form factor wise was about as good as it was going to get, you know, considering it does MIDI and has the five loops and you can switch the order of them and just so many possibilities. So yeah, lots and lots of positives. The only downside, like I said, is that whole parallel thing. And that seems to be a bit of a common thread when it comes to digital products like this. So no massive bummer about that. I like it, I dig this thing. JDello85 asks, do you have a favorite way to mic your cab during recording? What mic into what pre or just DI? Well, as you can see right here, if I scroll over, I just have another one of these, an SM7B. I really don't have a very good mic collection at home at all. So I would definitely like to improve that situation. And in which case, I've used a Bock. My buddy James Ballantyne lent me one of his Bock microphones before, which was really nice. They are not the cheapest guy on the block though, unfortunately. There are lots of options. John Davis is the best person to ask about that. At the Bunker or at John Davis NYC on Instagram. He's mic'd and recorded most of my albums over the last 15 years, so he could tell you exactly what mic was used on exactly what recording. It depends what I'm doing. The DI can sound great if it's a super affected signal, and I'm totally fine with that. I don't need so much of the amp or the mic on the cabinet. If there's some natural playing going on and it's really more the acoustic sound of the electric bass, then yeah, I absolutely like the mic. I like the DI a little less in that case. Ben_Hens asks, as a bassist, what is advice you'd give to another musician to blend in a band? So you're asking me what I would advise a keyboard player or a guitar player or drummer to do potentially to blend into a band? I don't know that I would recommend they blend in. Again, it's all about context, right? Are we talking about being hired as a sideman on the road with a pop artist? Then yeah, you blend. Do you get that blend knob and blend into the band and do what they say and show up on time and wear the right clothes, say the right things, drink the right drink, play the right notes. That's not my scene at all. So I'm not, when I hire a musician to get in a band, in my band or a band I'm maybe directing, or I'm not asking them to blend in. I'm hiring the musician for who they are and what they do almost 100% of the time. So blend is definitely not a characteristic I'm looking for now, but we're talking about me being middle-aged and being past a whole chunk of sideman, touring portion of my career. So things have changed. I'm maybe not the best person to advise you on that right now. Eduardo.Betanzos asks, do you use compressor pedals in live / studio situations? Yes, I do. I use this little guy most of the time. This is the Miura M2 compressor limiter. That's right up front, close to the front. Sometimes it's first, sometimes it's second in my signal chain. Depends where I want the preamp. And it's you don't really hear that much compression. It's just a little bit of warmth in there. It's not an overly compressed sound. It's not like a classic slap sound where there's compression in there. It's nothing like that. It's fairly light. And pretty much whenever you hear me, especially for the last 3 or 4 years since I've been using this, that's what you're hearing. That's part of my signal chain, is the tiniest amount of compression from that pedal. Jamie Wilkins Bass asks, what's your approach to writing B sections / additional themes once you've had an initial idea? Well, check this out. I used to think that's what I needed to do. I used to think, okay, I've got this A section melody. Now I need to write the chorus. Like, I have a verse and now I need to write the chorus. I gotta tell you, more often than not, the melody I had written already that I thought was a verse or an A section absolutely stood up as the chorus, as the B section. So quite often now, I'll use that as a tool, as a writing tool, and be like, oh, I wonder if I just move that forward 16 bars and then go back and concentrate on writing an A section. Maybe that's something you want to think about. Maybe that's something you want to consider. I feel like I have the chorus, the hook idea first. I have that kind of main theme idea first. And what needs to go around that for me more often than not is kind of the beginning and the bridge, rather than the bulk of the chorus and the main theme. Big C on Bass asks, what do you do when you're not sure what to practice? Great question. It is also why I've written so many of these books, because those exact things that you're asking about are in here. I've been writing them down and cataloging them and keeping a library of those kind of things. In fact, I'll show you one thing. This is a massive key right here. This is one of my transcription books. This is my handwritten scribble scratch. This is that's actually a guitar solo. There are a bunch of things in here, saxophone solos and piano solos and all kinds of stuff. But I have dozens of these. This is just, handwritten notes of transcriptions. At any time, I can go over to my massive shelf full of them over there. I can go over, I can pick one out at random, open it anywhere and go, oh man, I remember this. I remember listening to that record. I remember transcribing that melody or that solo or that bass line or those words or these chords or something. And I can be instantly re-inspired to work on that tiny idea once again and use that as part of my practice routine. That is yet another huge bonus and byproduct of transcribing and writing it down, notating it, because it lasts forever and will forever give you inspiration for your practice routine. And kind of related to our last question, Matt_1423 asks, what's the best way to start learning music theory? If you have a little bit of basic notation skill, or you can start to learn that, notating your transcriptions is a great way to go. And then being able to analyze that a little bit. Obviously, starting slowly. Don't go in there with something super complex and dense. Go in there with perhaps a set of chord changes that you know. Maybe it's a 12-bar blues. Maybe it's a pop song that just has 3 or 4 chords. Start simple, but start trying to associate certain sounds and certain notes with their, getting their kind of association and their context within a chord. So if you're seeing a melody note of A, to B flat to G to F, and the chord is F major, you're going to start to know that A is the third, B flat's the fourth or the 11th, G is the 9 or the 2, and F is the root. And you start piecing those things together slowly. Although I come from a classical background, my jazz harmony and that side of the theory that I eventually learned and know, yeah, okay, I know a lot about it at this point, and chord voicings and arranging and all that kind of stuff, orchestration, it really started out with trial and error and really doing this, doing the work on my own with a pencil and manuscript paper and recordings and learning it from records. And the more chords I transcribed and the more vertical harmony I transcribed the more I started to associate that with the beautiful lines and solos and melodies that I was first inspired perhaps to listen to that music by, as soon as I started putting those together, my theory started really coming together. And then, of course, yes, I'm studying some books and picking up things from here, there, and everywhere, basically. But start simple and really don't pressure yourself. You don't have to learn it all at once. Just if you can start picking out whether something's a major or a minor third on a chord, it's a great start. And if you can notate that, even better. Israel James Hunter asks, what are some of your favorite rhythms / styles not native to the US? Oh, so many. My first pull is towards Africa, African rhythms, especially West Africa. Oh, wow. I mean, just an insane amount of great music coming out of there. And you've like bass player, for instance, that we all know, Richard Bona from Cameroon, my good friend Lionel Lueke from Benin, from West Africa. That's just two people who are more known in our circles of jazz and in kind of US music a little bit more now. But that is just the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the amount of insanely good music that comes out of Africa. I would say I'm a huge fan of Cuban music. I'm a huge fan of Brazilian music. One of my first gigs ever was with Ayeto Moreira and Flora Purim. So yeah, massive fan of that vibe and of that sound, especially the baião, afoxé, samba, batucada, like those. Oh man, it's just I get really happy thinking about that. So yeah, absolutely. I like also like, you know, folk music from, you know, Sweden and Finland and stuff like that. Really amazing melodies, and it's just so much stuff. It's really hard to focus it into one or two things, because pretty much every time I go somewhere far away from where I live, I come back super inspired by what I've heard locally wherever I am. FPL328N asks, what happened to Two Bass Hit? Nothing happened to it. We've just been insanely busy the past few weeks. We will get back to it. We promise. We're rearranging the house, and Chelsea had some recording sessions. I've been doing video. It's just been a little crazy. So yeah, we will get back to it. I promise. Haha, yes, Seth asks, how do you maintain the motivation and inspiration to practice as much as you do? We don't have long. Like, we just don't have long enough. I don't have long enough to learn all the things I want to learn. And that alone is the biggest boot in the ass every day to get up and to get after it. And I'm just very aware of how little time I have to discover all the things that I know are out there and you know, learn all these skill sets that are out there that are super inspiring to me. Yeah. So yeah, it's just time and, you know, lack there of it. That is very motivational. Very last question. Here we go. It's from Eli Moradi, who asks, what mic should I use for recording bass for YouTube videos? For YouTube videos, if you can get your mixing situation in your door, maybe you use Logic or Pro Tools and you have a couple of nice plugins and a compressor and a nice mastering plugin, your DI should suffice. You know, don't be afraid to use a little bit of maybe delay or reverb or something, whatever it is, to give your situation a little bit of room space. Maybe you want to recreate that vibe of having a mic in the room by having like a little plate reverb or a room, probably a preset in Logic somewhere that just gives you a drum room or bass room or Studio B kind of reverb sound, and tweak that. Don't have the mix wide open. Have it way down, way less than you think. You know, if you've got a little room reverb, you know, try that mix at like 12%, not 40%. And that might give you a little bit of a vibe in terms of the sound of your bass and coming through the speakers with YouTube. Again, it's all kind of over compressed and kind of shitty sounding anyway by the time it comes out of YouTube, so I wouldn't stress out about it too much. And I think to really mic something well and to get a great result, you probably need to spend a little bit of money and have some expertise in miking and in recording. So if you want to keep it simple, I would say stick with the DI and stick with the path of least resistance. Okay, Cats, thank you for hanging out. This was a long one. Don't forget, all the books that we talked about and all the ones we didn't are linked below. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you're not already. Hit the bell to get notified when these videos are up, and hit the thumbs up. If you dig what you're saying, hit the thumbs up. It helps to push this content out there, to grow the channel, and to help me continue to make this free content for you guys. So thanks for hanging out. Thanks for spending some of your precious time with me on this Q&A. I will see you on the next video.